Hachette Audio presents Heroes for My Daughter, written and read by Brad Meltzer, featuring Lila Meltzer. Includes a Mac and PC compatible PDF of photos.
The title of this book is
Heroes for My Daughter
by Brad Meltzer. Who did I write this book for?
Me.
Who's me?
Lila.
You're my daughter?
Yeah.
This book's for you?
Mm-hmm.
My daughter, my hero. What do you think of this book?
It's cool.
As I read this book to you, I want you to know one thing, dear listener. My daughter Lila is in this recording studio with me. I'm staring at her right now, and everything I read is for you, but also for her. Acknowledgements. I have many heroes, but my favorite ones are always my little ones, my children, Lila, Jonas, and Theo, who are the three reasons this book exists. They inspire me, humble me, and forever remind me what true love is. My other hero is the woman who gave them to me, my wife Curie, who is absolute proof that mothers are the greatest heroes. On that note, this book only exists because of the work of my own mother, Terry Meltzer. When I was younger, she used to tell me that she saw her own arm off for me. Yes, she had a gift for overstating things, but she meant it. She really did. My mom gave me everything that she had and is the foundation of all I've become. It is in her memory that this book lives. Special love to my father, Stewie Meltzer, and my grandparents, Ben and Dottie Rubin, in whose memory this book was also completed. Also, a thank you to my sister, Barry, for being a great aunt and for being there for me, and to Noah Cutler for always, always pushing me so hard, especially with this one. As I started writing this book, it became one of the most personal things I've ever worked on, and that is thanks to Jill Neerum, who made sure that every page was all about my daughter Lila and my love for her. Special thanks also to Hope Denekamp, Carolyn Zimmerman, and everyone at the Neerum & Williams Agency, my treasured friend Larry Kirschbaum, the true godfather of this project, Simon Sinek, who told me my first inspiring story, Joel Marlin, who added the first pieces of research, Marie Grunbeck for being me, Catherine Blood and Jonathan Eaker from the Library of Congress, Jason Sherry, who made it all move, Chris Weiss, who inspired so much of this, my friend Goody Marshall, who's been there from book one, Bill Morrison, Jeff Zaslow, and the nice people of the Christopher and Dana Reeve Foundation, as well as the National Portrait Gallery. Also to Bob Miller, who put down the very first brick of this house, Rob Weisbach, who had faith before anyone, and all the real heroes who shared pictures and family stories. A personal thank you must also be said to my alter ego, Brad Desnoyer, who understands me like no one else. This house was built on his research, and while I love his help, what means far more is his friendship. Also thanks to the amazing Nick Morell. Without his hard work and photo finding, there'd be nothing to look at. Introduction. Dear Lila, my sweet daughter, I love you. And yes, I know every parent loves their child, but not like I love you. Someday you'll roll your eyes and groan, "Dad, you're embarrassing me." But right now, you're only 6 years old. So these days, you still smile your big beaming smile when I say things like that. And I point that out simply so that when these days are gone, I'll have proof that they existed. On the day that you were born, I remember your mom waking up at 4 o'clock in the morning, rolling over in bed and telling me, "I think the baby's coming." "Go back to bed," I pleaded, "it's too early." And God bless your mother, she actually tried to go back to bed. But you, my little unborn daughter, had your own ideas. And believe me when I say that wouldn't be the last time. At the hospital, the instant I saw you, my heart doubled in size. My own mother, your grandmother, Nana, told me at the time, "Now you'll understand how I love you." After giving us a few moments with you, the nurses did their usual weighing and measuring, and then said that they wanted to whisk you away for your first bath. "Oh, no," I said, "I'm coming with you," I told them, determined to protect you. They smiled that smile that they save for new parents, and they reassured me, "She's going to be fine, we have her." But as I looked down at my beautiful, teeny, amazing daughter, come on, no way was I ever letting you out of my sight. I had to protect you. Thankfully, the nurses put up with me and let me pretend I was some old parental veteran as I helped give you your first bath. Later, as I sat there, rocking in the rocking chair that they gave me and holding you close, I still remember all the dreams I was dreaming for you. I didn't just want one thing for you. I wanted everything. If you needed strength, I wanted you to be strong. If you saw someone hurting, I wanted you to find the compassion to help. If there was a problem, big or small, that no one can solve, I wanted you to have every available skill, ingenuity, empathy, creativity, perseverance, so you could attack that problem in a way that no one else on this entire planet had ever fathomed. And that would be your greatest gift, Lila, that no one, and I mean no one, would ever be exactly you. I still believe that. I do. I'm a mushy dad. And it was in those first moments of blind idealism and unbridled naivete that I resolved to write a book for you. That very night, 6 years ago, on the night you were born, I went home and started this book. My goal was to write it over the course of your life. I'd fill it with all the advice you needed to be a good person. I began the list that night. Number one, love God. Number two, help the kids who need it. My plan was to add more ideas as you grew older, and eventually, on the day when I presented this book to you, you'd realize I was indeed the greatest father of all time. I had a parade planned for myself as well. It was going to be fantastic. Thankfully, during your first few years, I realized that my cliched self-important plan was just that. It hit me after hearing the stories of heroes like Sally Ride. Because you know why Sally Ride was picked by NASA? Why did they choose her? Some say it was because she was a genius at physics, or that it was her physical resolve and athletic ability, or that she was simply fearless. And sure, it was probably all those things, but it was also because when she saw an ad in her college's newspaper looking for female astronauts, Sally Ride saw an opportunity and grabbed it. In that moment, she dared to attempt what no woman had done before. I love that story. I wanted you to hear that story. I wanted your brothers to hear that story. I wanted everyone in this world to know that if you take a chance and work hard, you can do anything in this world. Soon after, my new plan was born. I wouldn't give you a book of rules. I'd give you a book of heroes. And in that, I'd give you absolute proof that anything is possible. When you're older, this will be the point where you again roll your eyes and again groan, "Dad, did you just tell me anything is possible? You're embarrassing me again." I won't begrudge you, Lila. I did the same thing. But let me be clear. My dreams for you today are different from the ones on the day you were born. Sure, I still want everything for you. I always will. But amongst those dreams, there's one I keep coming back to. It's the dream that links every single hero in these pages. You'll see inside when you read it, my daughter. Every hero in here is a fighter. And Lila, no matter what stage of life you're in, when you want something, no matter how impossible it seems, you need to fight for it. When you believe in something, fight for it. And when you see injustice, fight harder than you've ever fought before. To see the results, read the story of Marie Curie, who never stopped pushing science forward, even when she was dying from the radiation she was studying. Or the story of Billie Jean King, who challenged and beat the pig-headed man who told her that women were weaker than men. Women are not weaker. Listen to that again, Lila. Women are not weaker. They are just as strong, just as resolute, just as creative, and are filled with just as much potential as any man. And yes, as your father, my instinct is to protect you, like that first day with the nurses. Other people will want to protect you too. But remember that you are not a damsel in distress waiting for some prince to come rescue you. Forget the prince. With your brain and your resourcefulness, you can rescue yourself. And when you have doubts, as we all inevitably do, you'll have this book, full of people who were racked with just as much fear, but who also found the internal strength to overcome it. From Amelia Earhart to Abigail Adams to every person in here, you'll see the stories of women and men who are no different from you and me. We may lionize them and put them up on pedestals, but never forget this: no one is born a hero. Every person in this book had moments where they were scared and terrified, like you, like me. So how did they achieve what they achieved? Because whatever their dreams were, big or small, for their country, for their family, or even for themselves, they never stopped fighting for what they loved. We all are who we are until that moment when we strive for something greater. Is that schmaltzy and naive? I hope so, because I want you to learn those things too. And so, my daughter, here is your book. This book is my dream for you. And it's a dream that was built by both myself and the most important hero of all, your mother. When you have doubts, there is strength inside. When you're ready to give up, there's motivation inside. And when you have questions, there are answers inside. But I hope you know, as every person in these pages proves, the best answers will always come from what's within you. I love you, my Lila Boo. Dad, a.k.a. Brad Meltzer, Fort Lauderdale, Florida, 2012. Brilliant. Marie Curie, scientist, researcher, Nobel Prize winner. As one of history's greatest scientists, Marie Curie was awarded 2 Nobel Prizes, one for physics and one for chemistry. As a woman, however, she was not invited to address the audience at the acceptance ceremony. Today, her findings on radiation are part of the most complex protocols for treating people with cancer. When she made her first revolutionary discovery, that radiation came from the interior of an atom, she could have stopped. She'd accomplished enough. When she pushed her theory forward, inventing the term radioactivity to describe her findings, she could have stopped. She'd accomplished enough. When she discovered 2 new elements, polonium and radium, and went on to become the first woman to win a Nobel Prize, she could have stopped. She'd accomplished enough. And when her husband died and the French government offered her support in the form of a pension, Marie Curie refused the money, saying that she could take care of her 2 daughters by herself. She did it by becoming the Sorbonne's first female lecturer and professor. From there, she went on to win her 2nd Nobel Prize, this one in chemistry, making her the first person to receive Nobel Prizes in 2 fields. She became so famous that when she traveled to the White House, President Harding presented her with a key to a lead-lined box that held 1 gram of radium. Worth more than $100,000, the radium was a gift from the women of America, who collected the money so Curie could continue her groundbreaking research. As she got older, Curie kept going, working with her daughter to find medical applications for her research. Indeed, even when she died from leukemia, after years of radiation exposure, we were still learning from her. Throughout her life, with so much accomplished, she could have stopped, she could have stopped, she could have stopped. Lucky for us, she didn't. One never notices what has been done. One can only see what remains to be done. Marie Curie. Champions. Mallory Holtman and Liz Wallace, softball players. As players on Central Washington University's softball team, Mallory Holtman and Liz Wallace lost a game of baseball and won the game of life. Western Oregon University senior Sarah Tucholsky had never hit a home run before, not in high school, not in college, not ever in her 21 years of playing softball. But at this doubleheader, with hecklers yelling at her, Tucholsky smashed the ball over the center field fence. Amazed at her home run, Tucholsky forgot to touch first base. As she quickly turned to correct her mistake...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.